With 9 million dog owners in Britain today, many of them are battling to be top dog at home.
Look, you can't go behind me.
But one man believes there's no such thing as a naughty dog.
I'm not going anywhere.
Just struggling owners.
Swamzy, enough!
You think you've got a problem now, and you have. You're really not in control.
And that's when master dog trainer Graeme Hall steps in to take on the nation's dog owners.
Whoa, whoa, whoa!
I've worked with almost every breed of dog and all kinds of dog behaviour problems, but 9 times out of 10, it's the owners that need to change their behaviour. And that is a really tough message to get across.
The problem I got with you is what you're not doing is any sort of correction at all.
With 12 years' experience, Graham's been put to the test thousands of times.
Come on, let's run.
And the results speak for themselves.
No.
Well done, baby.
Well done.
Honestly, it'll change my life.
It's early morning and Graham is preparing for a busy week on the road.
Bella.
In his casebook this week, a pair of Pomeranians in Northampton with a bad rep in the neighbourhood.
Lola. Lola.
Dot.
And a miniature Jack Russell, whose hound habit of running away could have fatal consequences.
I got a call and she said, Camilla, they're being threatened with a shotgun.
But for Graham's first challenge, he's headed to Leeds to meet a British bulldog with an appetite for destruction.
Let me have the bag, please.
Wilson!
Nicola got Wilson when he was just a pup.
Give up!
But 5 years on, she's lost all control of her canine.
As soon as I put something down, he'll take it and he'll destroy it.
I am sat on it.
Anything that I have is his.
That's the sofa!
He's destroyed countless throws, cushions from the living room.
And if he's not stripping the living room of its soft furnishings, he's stripping his owner.
Ow!
Literally.
Wilson, I'm wearing them!
Anything Wilson gets his teeth into, he claims as his own.
This happened to my friend's pair of designer glasses. He just snuck straight up and took them away. Socially, it's had a huge impact. My friends don't like to come here anymore.
Wilson hasn't always been this way.
He was 8 weeks old and he literally, when I first met him, fit in my hand, which was adorable. And he weed on me, which made me want him. A few years ago. I absolutely loved him, cuddling me on the sofa. But then everything sort of changed.
3 years ago, something happened which had a lasting impact on them both.
Wilson, come on.
I had a really bad car accident and he was in the car with me and...
Get in. Wilson.
He ended up in the footwell. It wasn't very nice and he was terrified of getting in the car.
Wilson, in.
Oh. I now have tinnitus and, well, it was severe hyperacusis where everything that is loud is... magnified massively and is so much louder. So if Wilson's barking and it's incessant barking, and sometimes I'm like, God, stop it, or I put my earplugs in to get away from it because it is really painful.
Get off!
While the accident has left Mum with physical injuries, it's had a lasting effect on Wilson's personality, turning him from a lovable rogue into a destructive demon.
Is really, really aggressive as soon as I try and get it off.
Ah! Wilson!
He's actually bitten me.
That's naughty, you hurt Mummy.
When you're wrestling with him, it's scary. It's upsetting, it makes me angry, it makes me anxious. And it's psychologically driving me around the twist.
Now Nicola feels she has no choice but to make a devastating decision.
I genuinely think I'm going to have to get rid of him. I absolutely love him to bits, but at the moment, I don't like him at all.
Off!
It would break my heart, but it's the only option.
Anybody want a bulldog?
A bulldog? bulldogs always make me smile. They're famously snuffly and grunting. But the biggest issue about bulldogs for me is that they're really stubborn. So once they get an idea in their head, it's that bulldog spirit. It takes a lot to shift it.
Arr, arr. You can tell he's a bulldog. Hello.
Hi, you all right? Nice to meet you.
You're all right. Hello, you.
He's got a pillow.
Oh, I see. Yeah, you're not kidding, are you? Has that just happened?
Literally just now. This is right. Wilson in his element.
Hello, you.
Don't put that anywhere, because he will eat it.
Oh, I'm with you. So how do you get that back off him?
I don't. He's so violent with it.
I mean, has he bitten you?
Yes, he bit me right through the knuckle a few months ago. I ended up having to have antibiotics.
Yeah.
Wilson, ah! Off! Off! Wilson, let go! Leave.
So you let go in the end.
So I let go because, yeah. I mean, I sat once for 45 minutes while he had my slipper and I had my slipper.
So it's almost like this battle of wills that he's winning well and truly, isn't he?
He always wins, yeah.
Is he getting enough exercise?
I try, but he doesn't want to walk. In order to get him to actually walk, I have to put him in the car.
Right.
Which is traumatic enough. I was in a car accident in 2015. Wilson was in the car with me. He was sat on the passenger seat and he ended up right in the footwell. And that has traumatised him because now he won't get in the car.
Right.
I just got hit from behind and I got really bad hyperacusis and tinnitus. Everything that I hear is a lot louder.
Okay.
So if he barks, it hurts. It really hurts, which again, my tolerance to him is lower because I can't stand the noise.
So what's going to happen if we can't fix it?
I'm going to have to really look to rehome him because it's just too much.
Yeah.
It really is.
If Graeme is going to get to the bottom of Wilson's destructive behaviour, he needs to understand what triggered it. So heads outside to see how Wilson reacts to getting in the car.
Come on, Wilson, in. Let's go.
Come on. He's not sure, is he?
The whole thing becomes such a huge ordeal that I'm not surprised he then doesn't want to get in because he's probably really stressed. Let's go.
And away he goes again. That car really is a traumatic place for him. And, you know, like humans, dogs can suffer post-traumatic stress. And one of the characteristics is destructive behaviour. So to fix that, I need to focus on the trigger. And that comes from his car accident and his fear around the car. So first of all, I need to sort that.
With the clock ticking, Graeme needs to tackle Wilson's PTSD ASAP.
Yeah, he's like, oh, I don't want to do that. I'm going to run away.
Dot!
Oh, off she goes. Oh, right.
Dot!
And he's got his hands full with a tiny terrier running an entire family ragged.
All right, come on, you.
Dot!
Dot!
Master dog trainer Graeme Hall travels the length and breadth of the country, coming to the rescue of desperate dog owners. Today, he's helping Nicola with her bullying bulldog. Graeme has witnessed Wilson's destructive behaviour, a symptom he believes stems from PTSD, following a traffic accident, meaning he's now terrified of getting into Mum's car.
Come on.
It's time for some home truths.
Clearly, there is no control of the old part. The most difficult problem you've got, without a doubt, is this sort of stealing items in the house, like the cushions and all that kind of thing.
I think over the months it's escalated and escalated and escalated, and now it's dangerous behaviour now. And that's what worries me now, that I know that he will bite me.
So I think the trigger for this was, you know, probably all that trauma he went through with the cars. I don't think it's that anymore. I think it is attention seeking. One of the things about PTSD is that dogs manifest that by being destructive.
Okay.
So who knew?
Makes sense.
If we've got any hope of having some control of him inside, then first we should start with the easy stuff outside. Let's make a start, shall we?
Let's go.
I do think a big part of Wilson's destructiveness is kind of attention seeking, but it really stems from that car accident and the anxiety around it. So the key to cracking his anxiety is to tackle his trigger points, and that's his fear of the car.
Every time the car door opens, Wilson's stress levels rise, and he resists being led to the vehicle.
Come on.
But Graeme thinks the solution is to lead by example and show Wilson he has nothing to fear by getting in the car.
So the problem we got at the moment is I'm going to this place that's really scary because I'm not prepared to. And he's going, mate, if you're not going in, I'm not going in. So do you know what I'm going to have to do? Jump in the back. Yeah? Come on then. Let's get in here. Yay, that's it. Clever boy. That's it. Hey, what's this? Oh, look. There we go.
With a bit of encouragement, Wilson happily gets in the car without putting up a fight.
So as soon as he put one paw up, yeah, good boy, bit of excitement. But I'm sat here just going, do you know what? It's all right, this. It's fine. I'm OK. Yeah. And I'll start to rub off. Mm-hmm.
Having coaxed Wilson into the car, Graeme wants Nicola to follow suit. And with the heavens having opened, they're hoping that Wilson might decide a dry car is a better option than standing outside in the rain.
So in you go.
Goodbye.
That's it, you go first.
Come on.
That's it, you're
good boy.
Go.
Come on, Wilson.
What if I go?
Come on.
Good boy.
Good boy.
Good boy. How's that, Nicola?
It's all right. He just needs a little bit of help, I think.
All I did was I just put myself behind him and just my leg was up against his bum, so I'm not actually shoving it. I'm just like, there's only one way to go here, young man.
Yeah.
So he's like, oh, OK, I'll do what my mum said.
Yeah.
I think we do this a few times. I know it's a bit of a pain, but it's that repetition that creates a new habit.
While he might have needed some strong persuasion the first few times...
Good boy.
A bit of praise and excitement.
Here he goes. Super.
Boy.
Soon has Wilson realising there's nothing to fear by jumping in the car. Something he's not been able to do since the accident.
Oh, there you go. Can you see the progression there? That looks like a normal dog getting in a car with a lady.
Good boy, Wilson.
Yeah, when he got in the car, he was just sat there all happy and, you know, he didn't seem anxious, he wasn't panting.
Boy.
Which is something I never ever thought would happen. And I'm so pleased. I really am.
Ready?
But having got Wilson over his fear of getting in cars, Graeme needs to tackle his destructive behaviour.
Wilson!
The hardest thing, though, is still to come, and I'm not kidding myself, because that problem inside, where he steals things and threatens Nicola, is really, I think, quite difficult. And I need to come up with a system that's easy to understand, something that Nicola can be really consistent with. And that's what I'm going to do next time.
It's the next morning and Graeme is heading further north to meet a lady...
Dot!
..who has the run of an 18-acre estate.
Dot!
Great escape artist, Dot.
Dot, where are you? Dotty? Dot!
Once she's out of the house...
Dot!
..the world is her oyster.
Quick. Dot!
And she doesn't pay a blind bit of notice to owner Camilla.
I will leg it after her. And she just runs off and I can't catch her.
Dot! Dot!
She does not come back for recall.
And the only one who can keep up with her is her sidekick, Beetle.
Oh, my God! Dot! Beetle! Dot!
She's a little dog who likes to hunt. She's got a rabbit, I just heard it. Gone. That's it. Bang. She'll chase squirrels, foxes, badgers. She has chased sheep before.
Dot. Dot!
I know that if Dot wasn't here, Beetle would be much easier to handle because she wouldn't be tempted to go off with her friend.
But Dot's love of running off on the hunt has almost had deadly consequences.
She started to run. And then a lovely lady rang and she said they're in a stable. The lady who's found them is saying they're going to be shot unless you come and pick them up. And they've been chasing animals and they've been very, 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 very naughty.
Where have you been?
Tragically, the family has already lost one beloved runaway pet, Dot's old companion, Isla.
So this is the collage of Isla. I think that Dot has learnt quite a lot of her bad behaviour from being brought up with Isla, who was another runner.
Isla died after being run over on the busy A road right next to the grounds, leaving the family devastated.
It makes us very fearful having a road like this close by when you've got an escape artist like this. In my mind, I've lost her once a week. twice a week. So I go through all the motions. How am I going to tell the children? How are they going to react? Where are we going to bury her?
Come on.
Having lost one dog to the road, the pressure is on Graeme to get this runaway reined in.
Some dogs are a lot easier to train and recall than others, but probably the most difficult are terriers, and Jack Russells in particular. They were bred to go down rabbit holes and hunt. It's a really difficult challenge, this. Hello.
Graeme, how
are you? Hi, nice to meet you.
And true to form, Dot is desperate to escape Camilla's clutches.
Waiting in great anticipation for your arrival.
Oh, good. Oh,
he's
there
great now, Dotty.
And make a clean break for it.
Dot!
Oh, off she goes. Oh, come on, we better go and find her.
She's probably going to leg it now. Dot!
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 Dot! Dot, come here. Dot! 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 Come on!
Right, come on, Jack.
Come here, Dot! Dot! Ah!
Dot!
I'm totally happy about where she is now, because we're not near the road, because I know she's safe in this particular
okay.
bit.
So that I can hear the road behind
yes.
us.
Yes, and it's a very busy road, dual carriageway.
Yeah.
And we've sadly already lost a dog there on the
okay.
road.
Well, listen, I don't want to risk anything. We better find her.
Well, let's go and have a look, right. see where she is. Dot! Come on!
With even Beetle not knowing where her partner in crime is, the hunt for Dot turns into a waiting game.
Some point, when Dot's ready, she'll appear.
Yeah.
But and I don't know when that could
and
be.
And that's the key phrase, when Dot's ready.
When Dot's ready. Dot! Come here! Dot! No. No sign.
But living on such a huge estate means there's no end of places where she may be.
She could run all the way down there where she has been known to go in the past.
Right.
Which is a terrible scenario. One particular time, I got a call from a lady. She said, Camilla, there's a young girl on a horse and the dogs were sort of jumpy and yappy because they were nervous and they knew they shouldn't
yeah,
be there and
course.
They were egging each other on and they're being threatened with a shotgun.
Crikey.
It was a horrible situation,
yeah.
actually. That can't happen again.
There's no control here, is there?
No.
So we need to fix that.
Please, if we could, I'd be very grateful.
But first we need to get her back.
Yes. Dot!
Dussy!
Come here! Dot!
Oh, there she is.
Here. Come here.
Yay, good girl!
Come here.
That's it, gotcha.
So that's quite...
That was lucky.
Yes.
There are an abundance of temptations out here for her. You know, rabbits, mice, birds, and that's what Camilla's got to compete with in order to get her back. And frankly, Camilla's tone of voice isn't exactly enticing. It's terrifying. So I don't really blame Dot for not coming back for Camilla.
But you see, that's perfect example of what will happen three times a day.
Okay.
So a walk that might take 20 minutes could take 2 hours.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm missing appointments, late for school meetings.
Right.
Mummy, why are you always late at the netball matches?
Yeah.
What I'd love to do is not have her on the lead and have a normal walk with her sort of coming when I call her.
There was a pretty good chance there. She'd have been down the hole and...
Oh, yeah, and out when she's ready.
This is an idyllic setting, but if you're a dog like Dot with no recall, it's actually a very dangerous place. There are rabbit holes that she can disappear down. She's been caught and been threatened with being shot. And behind the house in this direction, there's a main dual carriageway. And this family have already had a dog killed on that road. Frankly, it's a matter of time. I need to fix this recall problem.
With Dot safely in Camilla's arms, they head back to the house, where Graeme shares his words of wisdom.
The cardinal sin of dog recall is don't call your dog back with an angry voice.
Right, OK.
Which you do.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you realise.
Yes, I'm sure, yeah.
You wouldn't run back to somebody who shouted to you
yeah.
like that. What I'm seeing, it's hard to put a finger on it, but there's no bond between you. She does her own sweet thing.
Yes.
And you're powerless.
Yeah.
Does that sound right to you?
Well, it's difficult to bond with a dog that is never around to bond with.
Yeah.
So she's not a cosy, cuddly dog.
Right.
She's a sniffing, running, hunting type of dog.
This is... This is a Jack Russell. She's got strong hunting instincts. So what I'm asking myself to do here is go against Mother Nature and teach a dog who doesn't want to come back when you call her.
I've never seen anyone else get her back.
Right.
So it makes me think, well, she's never going to come back. She's
okay.
not bothered about coming back.
Yeah, yeah.
So if I could see you
right.
working your magic, then I'm sure it would give me the confidence to say, I can do this.
Well, hopefully we can go a stage further than that, because rather than just me demonstrating it, I need to get you doing it for yourself.
Yeah.
And if you know that you can do it, then I can drive away from here and we're on the right track.
That'd be great.
Shall we go find her?
Let's do it. Come on, Graeme.
Getting that dog to come back is a really big ask. Frankly, it's going to take a lot more than Camilla just changing the tone of her voice in order to get Dot back, because these grounds are vast and that terrier can be out of earshot really, really quickly. So I'm going to have a think about how we do this.
Coming up, with a little life on the line, recall training has never been more important.
I'm going to suggest something that I don't normally do, and that's a whistle.
And in Northampton, Graham's ankles are on the menu.
He's quite nippy.
As he takes on two piercing Pomeranians.
Slimy.
Master dog trainer Graeme Hall works tirelessly coming to the aid of desperate dog owners.
Dot!
Having helped Camilla track down her runaway mini Jack Russell on the 18-acre estate she lives on, which borders a busy dual carriageway.
It makes us very fearful having a road like this close by.
Graham wants to work on Camilla and Dot's relationship and teach this tiny tearaway to come back to her mistress on command. To start, Graham's using the safety of a 30-foot long line so Camilla can give a quick tug to show Dot what's expected of her when she calls her name.
The recall command needs to be nice and bright and happy. Now, you could use your voice. Instead of that, Dot, come here, sort of angry sound, it would need to be very much, you know, Dot, here. But in a place like this, your voice might not carry enough. So I'm going to suggest something that I don't normally do, and that's a whistle. I've got a couple, one for you, one for me.
Thank you, Graham. Lovely.
But with the temptation of foxholes and farms being so strong, Graham thinks it'll take more than a whistle and a flick to bring Dot to heel. He wants Camilla to make Dot as excited about running back to her as she is about her hunting trips.
What we're now going to do is associate the sound of the whistle with something good happening when she comes back, right? So we need a reward. Now, we could use treats, but what she really wants is a little furry thing that squeaks.
Oh,
she liked the sound of that.
Yeah, ears are up.
Now, if she comes back to the whistle, right, we get all terribly excited, we squeak the squeaky thing. If we start going backwards, she's got to speed up to catch us. Mm-hmm. It creates that urgency.
If she comes.
And if she comes.
Praise and adoration.
There's something in it for her.
And squeaky hairy cow.
That's it.
Graham's plan is to tempt her back to Camilla and the kids with fun and excitement. So he takes the lead to show her exactly what he wants.
Yeah, good girl! Come on then! She's a clever girl!
Although the toy piques her interest, it's not quite enough to get her to return all the way.
OK, it's probably not her favourite toy in the world.
So Graham has another trick in his bag.
It's a cheese.
Oh, he looks quite interested.
Well, she does look, she's smelled those.
Dot, do you like cheese? I don't really think of dogs and cheese. I mean, who thinks of dogs and cheese? I think dogs and bone, dogs and chicken, dogs and biscuits. But dogs and cheese, it's a new one.
Now with a cube of cheese on the menu and Camilla channeling her positive voice, can she get Dot to return?
Yeah, clever girl! That's super!
Good girl.
Who's a clever girl? Yay! I'll do. How happy is she? Look at that waggy tail. Loving the whole family getting involved. Everybody's cheering her on. So what we're beginning to see now is when we blow that whistle, peep, peep, straight away now, she's going, yep, I've got to come back. Dotty! Come on, Dotty. Then! Yay! Yeah. She's a clever girl.
I've never seen this dog so animated, Graham. The last time I saw her looking like that was when somebody held up a dead rabbit that she'd caught.
Right.
Well, she's a good student, Graham.
She is.
With Dot coming back each time to Mum, Graham wants to challenge Camilla.
In order to transition from having the long line on to no line at all, we need to get used to you not being attached to it.
Yeah.
If you drop the long line...
So I don't actually hold this lead?
I don't think you need to now. I think you've done really well today. So,
okay.
So from here on in, I think you can come out. If in doubt, you can always pick it up and hold it.
Yes.
As you are today.
Yes.
But I think most of the time, you can let her just go with you and trail it behind. We're going to blow the whistle and peep her.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
And I'm hoping she'll still come back.
I think she would. Dotty!
Yes, straight away.
Good girl.
Fantastic.
Come on, my Dotty.
Yay! Come on,
my
Dotty.
Until Dot's recall is ingrained in her, which will take weeks more practice, Graham wants to keep her long lead attached.
How about that?
But by letting it trail behind her, it gives Dot the feeling of being free and Camilla the safety net of being able to grab her. But to prove that the bond between them is already stronger than it was a few hours ago, Graeme throws in one last test.
I've got a bit of cheek, so I'm going to distract her away. Let's see if you can distract her away from me.
Right.
Well, it's this. So you don't have hold of that lead at all now.
No.
And she knows I've got a bit of cheese.
Right.
So make those peeps good.
Hey, dog, come on. Hey, dog, come on. Hey, dog, come on.
Fantastic, look at that.
Good girl.
That's Rico.
Good girl, that's Rico. Oh, good girl, dog. Oh, the training has been fantastic. I feel really happy. I hope now that we've got a safe relationship moving forward.
With practice, Graeme believes Dot won't need to be attached to a long lead. And to build up to removing it completely, he's got a top tip will help them both.
In order to transition from long lead on to no lead on, we're going to snip that lead bit by bit every week, and it may take a few months, but in the end, that dog will be coming back super reliably, I'm sure.
Happy that Dot can now be recalled away from danger, Graeme leaves Camilla to carry on with the training.
This morning, it really looked as though this was a disaster waiting to happen. Now it doesn't. There's a bond now. You can see that Dot really wants to run back to Camilla. But a bit of practice, that'll be a fantastic recall.
It's a new day, and Graeme is on his way to meet two dogs whose barks are as bad as their bites.
The dogs I'm going to see have a reputation in the neighbourhood as antisocial dogs. So are they German Shepherds or Rottweilers, Dobermans perhaps? Yeah, they're Pomeranians.
Lola! Lola!
When Danielle moved to a brand new home 15 months ago with parents Jeanette and Tony, it wasn't long before her two Pomeranians made themselves known in the local neighbourhood.
Bella!
Now where we live, it's more sort of close sort of community. And it's sort of embarrassing when we're walking the dogs. You get the same people like, oh, can you shut that dog up or something like that. We don't want them to have a reputation.
Having wanted to make new friends, the family has in fact avoided inviting people round. Because if Bella and Lola aren't barking at them, they're going for their ankles.
We have to protect our guests. They'd just go straight for their legs. And I couldn't just have someone come in on the off chance for tea or anything because, well, you just know how these are going to react.
And making a good impression on the neighbours isn't possible when your first introduction to them is handing back their ripped-up post.
Because we live on a new estate, we sometimes get people's posts come through our door because their address is not fully registered yet. It's a mammoth task to just get the post before they eat it. And we're having to send it back to the neighbour, like, I'm sorry. It's so embarrassing when that happens.
Bella and Lola's reaction to anything that comes through a door has started to cause friction with Dad Tony, who's now banned them from coming into the family-run business.
Bella! Bella!
It does create a bit of a wedge in our family because my husband, he won't have Bella and Lola into our place of work because of the way they behave.
With tensions high, Danielle and Jeanette are desperate to transform this anarchic pair into perfect Pomeranians.
Bella and Lola are loving dogs.
They're literally our best friends. But we just feel like we definitely need help. It's just been going on far too long now.
Now, Pomeranians are tiny dogs, but they're closely related to sled dogs. They used to be much, much bigger, but it's certainly a breed that I'd put in a category of little dog, big dog attitude.
With this couple reacting to anything coming through the door, be it post or person, Graeme's on tenterhooks as he approaches the house.
Hello.
Hi.
Oh, hello, hello. Hiya. Right, shall I come in? Blimey. She's not happy, is she?
No, not when we get a visitor.
She's quite nippy.
Yeah, she does sort of bite your ankle or feet.
We're always on edge.
With the dogs finally calmed, it's time for a more civilised chat.
So any movement at all and Bella's off on one,
yeah.
And potentially biting. I mean, what effect is that having on you?
Yeah, we've been moved in, what, 15 months? And it would be lovely to invite my immediate neighbours around for a drink one evening.
We didn't even have a housewarming, did we?
No.
For that reason, the dogs. They just prevent us from doing a lot of things.
They're ruling your lives, aren't they?
Yeah.
And I think when you come to a new build estate, nobody knows anybody, so everybody's trying to get to know each other and stuff from it.
Yeah. We sometimes get neighbours' posts come in by accident, and when it does, and Bella's already sort of been to it first and ripped it up, we sort of have to go around like, I'm so sorry.
This is your post in 13 pieces.
Yeah. It just gets a bit embarrassing. Even my dad has had enough of them.
Is that the post?
Yeah. Yeah, that's
right. But as usual, the pacey Poms get there first.
Bella, leave.
Right. Well, that sort of survived.
That's quite a good one, actually.
Well, we were pretty quick, weren't we?
Yeah.
And if you put her down now, what would happen? Would she go for it? No, not bothered, actually. She's sniffing it, but no, nothing. Dogs barking and nipping at anything that comes through the front door is, well, bread and butter to me. But 9 times out of 10, it's the owner's reaction that's making things worse. Jeanette and Danielle are just shouting the dogs' names, which is just riling them up. Or they're picking them up, which they think is helping, but is actually rewarding aggressive behaviour.
And Graeme thinks he's spotted a pattern in the way Bella and Lola react to any activity at the door.
It looks, just to the untrained eye, like two dogs doing the same thing.
Yeah.
But actually it's not. Bella's the problem. Yeah. She's the one going at people, ripping the poster bits.
Yeah.
So if you think about it, if we focus on Bella, then probably Lola will fall into line. There is one big thing that you're doing, and it's understandable, but it's having the wrong effect. You pick them up.
Yeah. Right?
Bella in particular. So you might as well be saying in dog language, oh, if you go to bite people, we'll love you for it.
Okay.
That makes sense?
Yeah, it does, yeah.
For me, that's good news, because we could change that and that should make a big difference.
Graeme wants Danielle and Jeanette to regain control by getting in the way of the dogs and whatever is at the door until they no longer make a fuss.
The voice needs to be quite clear. I'm going to keep it nice and simple. We're going to go, no, back up, right? And that happens as we're moving them backwards. I call it snow ploughing. Because, when they move, I'll praise them for it.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Let's do that
then. No, back up.
Leg.
No. No.
Right. So what did you do wrong?
I didn't put my leg in the way.
Listen, actions speak louder than words. What went wrong there, as it's falling, you're going back up.
Yeah, I need to get in the way of her.
Lock.
Yeah.
Not bump her out of the way, but just like, no.
Yeah.
I don't think so, you know.
Okay.
Graham's approach is super simple, but only if Danielle can get her timings right.
No!
Swing your leg.
No, back up.
Walk into it.
No, back up.
Wait for it. Good.
With each attempt, Danielle's timing and blocking gets better. And coupled with praise...
Okay.
Bella gets calmer.
Good.
Oh, how good was that?
Have you ever been able to get a piece of mail delivered with the dogs in the vicinity without it getting chewed up?
Never.
No. Lola's not a problem now, have you noticed?
No, it's not at all.
You've really only got one dog to worry about.
Now you've fixed Bella.
With the dogs now calmer when the post comes through, Graeme wants to up the ante by asking them to adopt a similar block and command technique when someone comes through the door.
No, back up.
And you're going to swing your other leg in position to block if you have to.
With Graeme guiding Jeanette through the steps...
Good girl, well done.
Bella barely makes a peep.
That was brilliant. Yeah. I feel so proud.
So you should.
Yeah.
In the 15 months living in the house, these Pomeranians have patrolled the door and attacked anything which came through it. But with a simple technique and some praise...
We have silence in the house.
The barking I wasn't focusing on. Pomeranians are pretty barky anyway.
Yeah.
My first concern was this habit of hers of nipping at people, biting their ankles, their shoes. Mm. But actually what's happened, as if by magic, is the barking's gone away too.
Yeah.
And it's in the nick of time as Dad Tony returns from work.
Hello.
Hiya. Hi. Nice to meet you.
Hiya.
Tony, isn't it?
Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
How's it going? Good God. How's it going?
It's gone really well.
Where's Lola?
Lola. She's so calm, she hasn't even arrived. Lola!
Yeah.
Good girl.
Good God.
They're like new dogs. We'll be able to have the neighbours around now.
Yeah, I reckon you can.
Yeah.
It would be nice, wouldn't it?
That's it.
I know that Jeanette and Danielle love the dogs, but to me they were more of a hindrance. They're too embarrassing. But after today, I can eat my words.
Right.
See you, mate. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. All the best.
Bye.
See ya.
Ta-ra, bye.
Bye now.
Still to come, having tackled Bulldog Wilson's PTSD trigger, Graham needs to deal with his destructive ways.
I don't even try anymore.
It's coming to the end of his working week and Graham's back in Leeds to help Nicola stop her bulldog's destructive behaviour inside her home.
Get off, man!
So far, he's successfully got Wilson over his extreme fear of getting into cars, which he believes triggered all of his bad behaviour.
We've got to remember that Wilson was involved in this serious car accident. That caused him to have a post-traumatic stress. Now, one of the features of that is they often get destructive. But I think it's moved on from that. This is attention-seeking.
But if Graham can't improve Wilson's behaviour inside the house, Nicola feels she has no choice but to explore the options for rehoming.
Morning.
Hi, good
Hello,
morning.
Hello, you. Come on, Wilson. Good boy. Hello, you. I think this is the most difficult bit inside.
It's going to take some undoing, I think.
Yeah, I think that's right. He's about to have that cushion, actually. Oi!
If I can get to it just before him,
yeah,
we're all right.
You're all
but
right.
If I try now... I don't even try anymore. I'm generally scared.
If you leave him, am I right in saying he wouldn't damage them?
He's not interested. I go to work and I can leave these out and they're exactly where they are.
What happens if you try and distract him?
Doesn't work.
I mean, I've even tried going to the door and knocking on the door and going, oh, hi!
Oh, hello!
And it's like I'm having a conversation with myself to try and distract him from eating a pillow that really I'm not that bothered about, but it's the principle.
It is.
Oh, it's ridiculous.
Well, Nicola's tried everything. She's tried telling him off, distracting him, fighting him, shouting at him, and it's not working. We need a different approach. And you know what? It's really, really simple.
Believing Wilson is taking things to get Nicola's attention to ease his anxiety...
Wilson, let go!
Graham has come up with a simple solution. Ignoring him.
That's quite interesting, because he's going round in circles now.
Is he? Is he just chewing it?
Yeah, he's kind of sucking on a corner of it, really. That's interesting. He's actually walked away from it. And the thing to do when he walks away from it is give him attention.
What?
Now, if he goes back to it, we go back to the book.
No.
Clever boy.
Good boy.
Right.
Let's go in.
So he's so disinterested in it now, he's left the room.
He's just lying down in the kitchen. I'm amazed. I didn't think that would work.
These files are just a mechanism that makes it obvious we're ignoring
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
So we're starting to change the wiring in his head, which is, I never wanted this for itself anyway. I wanted this because if I got this, I got me mum.
Yeah.
And we're going, no, if you've got that, you lose your mum.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but if you walk away from it, then you get some love. Pretty simple, huh?
Yeah. So simple, so complex.
But I think we should up the ante.
Yeah.
Cushions aren't the only things he steals, obviously.
Anything. Lovely.
Nice, aren't they? Okay. So if you want to sort of leave them carelessly lying around, and let's see what he does. Okay. If he does go for it, same again. Here we go. Mm. He's a little devil, isn't he?
Straight
right, away. So come on, up with the book.
Interesting that he's just holding them. If he wanted to destroy them, he would rip them to bits.
Wilson has had no attention for 5 minutes. He still has the glasses in his mouth, but they're intact.
So our only chance is staying calm and kind of ignoring
it. Yeah.
And it's harder, this.
He may not have destroyed the glasses, but Wilson's not let them go either.
There
So Graeme decides to take his strategy of ignoring him up a notch.
So we've still got a problem. We've still got the sunglasses back. But he's coming this way again, then.
He seems really relaxed.
While he's calmer, we might just go, hey, Wilson, come here, look, we're playing with a ball.
Yeah.
Hey, Wilson, what's this?
Good boy.
Oh, very good. Good boy. Super. While you do that, I'll go get those sunglasses.
Cool. Where is he, darling? Ready?
Well, they're in great, Nick. Take him out to Nicola, I think. Here we go.
Glasses! Yes!
So, yeah, let me put my own back on, but they're an amazing, Nick. Look at that.
They're not broken, they're not snapped, they're not chewed.
They're not even scratched.
They're just...
It's amazing.
Dirty.
It takes a long time to bed in a new habit. Practice, you know. So he starts to get into this new habit of mummy loves me when I'm not demanding attention in that nasty way. Mummy's not going to threaten me to get things off me, and it's just easier for him to let go. But there is a big question still on my mind, and it's this. When we first met, you said if we couldn't get this fixed in a few weeks, you would have to rehome him.
Yeah. All I wanted was to know that there is a possible future of me and keeping Wilson.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's definitely possible now. Thank you very much indeed.
Don't want you to go.
Oh, bless you.
I really, honestly, really appreciate it. And genuinely, it'll change my life.
Right, I'll leave you with it.
Thank you.
He's fast asleep. Bye-bye now.
See you later.
Take care.
Genuinely didn't think we'd find any kind of solution. What Graeme's shown me is a lot of it is me and how I respond and how I control Wilson. I'd think now that we'll be able to keep him and that I'll be happy.
Well, this has been a tricky case. We've had to tackle the triggers for Wilson's anxiety, but I'm absolutely delighted with the way it's gone. And by Nicola not pandering to Wilson's attention seeking, she's now confident that she won't have to rehome him. What a result.
Wilson is well and truly over his fear of the car and has turned from destructive to docile.
I am in control for once. Thank you, Graeme. You are a genius.
Dot is still playing Lady of the Manor with the run of the huge estate, but this time it's with Camilla.
Good girl!
And Jeanette and Danielle have finally planned a housewarming with a now quiet Bella and Lola, the guests of honour.
Love you.
Next time, a spaniel pointer cross from the West Midlands who has her police officer owner under house arrest. In Leicester, a Siberian husky whose warm welcome is scaring off visitors.
I think he got me there.
And a couple whose love of dogs is breaching the peace.
George, out.
Rachel's gone that way, Chris has gone that way, the dogs are like this. Man.